Come Holy Spirit, move among us. Come Holy Spirit, flow living water, flow within us, flow living water. Come Holy Spirit, move among us. Come Holy Spirit, flow living water, flow within us, flow living water. Your love is alive, it's breaking the darkness, it's bringing the light to soften the heart of stone. Your love is alive.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your
Today, friends, having an eternal perspective, understanding that eternity changes everything, is in so many ways the key to living out the true Christ-following life. Now, the trend today in popular culture, or even right in the church as well, is to focus not on the eternal future, but on our present circumstances. And sometimes, somehow, a kind of a self-help gospel is preached to see how we can just change our current situation, our immediate circumstances, as if this current world were our eternal home. Yet Scripture states the reality of our eternal future should dominate and determine how we live right here, right now, even right down to the words we speak and the actions we take. Now, I want to read to us what Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 from verse 16 to 18. But just prior to verse 16, Paul speaks about the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and our hope is in the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and how God's grace and this good news of His grace is spreading. So let's pick up 2 Corinthians 4 from verse 16. That is why, what is the why? Okay, he's speaking about the resurrection prior to verse 16. This is why we never give up. Because Christ conquered death, because of His wonderful grace, that is why we never give up. Though our bodies are dying, our spirits are being renewed every day. For our present troubles are small and won't last very long, yet they produce for us a glory that vastly outweighs them and will last forever. So we don't look at the troubles we can see now. Rather, we fix our gaze on things that cannot be seen. For the things that we see now will soon be gone, but the things we cannot see will last forever. What will last forever? God and His Word will last forever. People, and investing in people, that will last forever. Life on earth matters not because it's the only life we have, but precisely because it isn't the only life we have. It's the beginning of a life that will continue without end. Life on this earth is just kind of the precursor of a life on the new earth. When living in the light of eternity, when we say that eternity changes everything, the things we focus on is important. And so here in closing to this preaching series, Eternity Changes Everything, I want to give us at least five eternal truths. There are many more, but may I just draw our attention to at least five eternal truths that we should remind ourselves of daily. Number one, two eternal destinations, heaven and hell. There are only two eternal destinations, and you and I and every person we know will go to one or the other, heaven or hell. Let's hear what Jesus said in Matthew 7 from verse 13 to 14. I want to read Matthew 7. You can enter God's kingdom only through the narrow gate. The highway to hell is broad, and its gate is wide for many who choose that way. But the gateway to life is very narrow, and the road is difficult, and only a few ever find it. Now friends, if you've placed your faith in Christ and trusted Him for your salvation, then this world is the closest thing to hell you will ever experience. Everything that is wrong in this life will be made right on the new earth, where you will live forever in the presence of Jesus Christ. And so we can say, thank you, Jesus, that the best is yet to be. Even though things on this earth might still turn out pretty bad for us, God will one day clear away sin, death, sorrow, pain, sickness, just like boulders clear away a rubble site and preparing this building site from all rubble so that they can begin a new construction. And so if you have not yet placed your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ as the only God and Savior, the only way, the truth, the life, then life on this current earth is the closest you will come to heaven. The best is not yet to be, but the worst is yet to be. And so I want to encourage you to investigate the person and the claims of Jesus Christ and his finished work. Because all roads do not lead to heaven. Only one does, Jesus Christ. Jesus himself said, no one comes to the Father except through me. All other roads lead to hell. And the reality of hell should break the hearts of Christ followers. It should bring Christ followers to their knees as we experience and have tasted the mercy of God. And we need to take the mercy of God and the good news of Jesus Christ to those that are without Christ and that are without hope and a future in this world. And just share the costly forgiveness that God is extending to us in the person and the finished work of Jesus Christ, that we can experience and taste His mercy and His unconditional love. And so the second eternal truth that we should remind ourselves of is my choices and actions. My choices and actions in this life have a direct influence in the world and the life to come. Let us read Revelation 22, verse 12. Look, I am coming soon. Jesus is speaking here. Look, I am coming soon, bringing my reward with me to repay all people according to their deeds. What we do in this life is of eternal importance. You and I will never have another chance to move the hand of God through prayer, to heal a hurting soul, to pray for the sick, to share Christ with someone who can be saved from hell, to care for the sick, to serve a meal for those who are starving and hungry, to practice hospitality, to comfort the dying, to rescue the unborn and speak up against the injustice of abortion, translate scriptures, bring the gospel to an unreached people group, whether it's in Zambia or in Egypt or wherever. It's only on this temporary earth, this current earth, that we have the opportunity to do those things. And so friends, when we view today in the light of the long tomorrow, eternity changes everything. And even the little choices we make become very, very important. And so the third thing that I want to remind us that we should remind ourselves of is the audience of one. The audience of one. My life is being examined by God, the audience of one. And the only assessment of my life and your life that will ultimately matter is God's assessment. You and I live and worship ultimately before the audience of one. Hear what Paul has to say in Romans 14, verse 12. Each of us will give a personal account to God. Now ask yourself whether you are living for the approval of this culture, the world around us, or for the approval of Jesus. We are going to give an account to Jesus. We're not giving an account to the culture and what forces us and give account to peer pressure and things. No, we are to live out our lives before the audience of one. His approval is the one that matters. Is it our goal to hear other people say, well done? Or do we want rather to hear Jesus say, well done, good and faithful servant? Fourth thing that we should remind ourselves daily, fourth eternal truth is God is sovereign. And this is very important. This is something very important that we should understand and grow in. It's something for us as a local church that we really focus on and hold so strong as an important biblical truth is the sovereignty of God, His sovereignty and His grace. God is sovereign, and I can trust that He is working all things. He is working all things, including the most difficult things, the good, the bad, and the ugly. He is working those things in my life together for my good and ultimately for His glory. As Paul says in Ephesians 1, for the praise of His glory, for His praise, for His glory. Let us read Romans chapter 8, verse 28. And we know that God causes everything to work together, or God works everything. We know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to His purpose for them. You see, friends, God works in everything. Can I read you two other scriptures? Ephesians chapter 1, verse 11. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 11, it says the following to us. Furthermore, because we are united to Christ, we are one in Christ, we have received an inheritance from God. Our inheritance comes from our identity being in Christ. For He chose us in advance, and He makes everything work out according to His plan. You see, friends, God makes everything work out according to His plan. And those first couple of verses, we see Paul writes about Jesus Christ coming at exactly the right time, dying in our place for our sins. And he further states there that, you know, God chose us. He, even in advance, before I even have made that decision to acknowledge and follow Christ as my Lord and Savior, He chose me in Him. And He works out everything according to His purpose and His plan. There are so many other scriptures that God works out things according to His plan. The Bible is full of the sovereignty of God. May I give you another scripture? Daniel chapter 5, verse, or rather Daniel chapter 4, verse 35. Daniel chapter 4. Verse 35. Let me read actually from verse 34. Just reminding you that after this time had passed, Nebuchadnezzar looked up to heaven, his sanity returned, he praised and worshipped the Most High, honored the one who lives forever. And then Nebuchadnezzar says, His rule is everlasting and His kingdom is eternal. All the people on the earth are nothing compared to Him. He does as He pleases among the angels of heaven and among the people of the earth. No one can stop Him or say to Him, "What do you mean by doing these things?" God does whatever He pleases. Friends, in the midst of a world that groans under the suffering and evil, God's main concern is conforming His children to the image of Christ. And that's what we read in Romans 8. And we know that He works through challenging circumstances. He works those challenging circumstances of our lives to help develop that Christ-likeness in us. And we can be assured that whatever difficulty He has allowed in our lives, whatever difficulty He has allowed in His sovereign will and wisdom and mercy, we know that, that those difficulties, those challenging moments have so-called, been father filtered through His fingers, through the sovereign goodness of our Heavenly Father that is a good, good Father. He has filtered those events and those difficult moments have been filtered through the fingers of His wisdom and love. Romans 11 says we cannot fathom the depth and the riches of His wisdom, of His knowledge. We can know that our Heavenly Father is a good, good Father. All wisdom belongs to Him. He is all wise. We cannot always understand His knowledge and His ways. As Daniel said, or rather Nebuchadnezzar speaks and God reveals this to him, and Daniel says, God does what He pleases. We will not always understand this, but you and I can trust that whatever is happening is filtered through my heavenly perfect Father's fingers of wisdom and love and mercy. We have no reason to think that God is any less trustworthy with regards to Romans 8 verse 28 than with any other promise He has made in His Word. Why do we believe other promises in His Word, but when it comes to Romans 8 verse 28, we find it hard to believe that God works in all things? By faith, friends, let us trust Him today that in eternity we will look back and see, wow, how Romans 8 verse 28 was absolutely true. When you live with eternity in mind, it infuses you with a joy and a peace that sustains you in your daily life, even as you face difficult things. Believing that God is working in all things together for good, that takes faith. It takes trust. It takes resting. To me, that is the greatest thing, the greatest rest and trust in my personal life, is that I can rest that God is sovereign. And even echoing the words of Joseph, where he said to his brothers, "You meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. God is working out." And for us to really take God on this promise and resting in that truth of the fact that He is working all things, resting in the promise of Romans 8 verse 28, that requires an eternal perspective of life and things. And so the fifth thing is my ultimate home. My ultimate home will be the new earth for those who are in Christ Jesus, where I will see and enjoy God and serve Him as a resurrected human being in a resurrected human society. Let's hear what Peter said in 2 Peter 3, verse 13. 2 Peter 3, verse 13. So Peter says the following: "But we are looking forward to the new heavens and new earth He has promised, a world filled with God's righteousness." So the question is resurrected living in a resurrected world with the resurrected Christ and His resurrected people, is that your daily longing and hope? Now, Peter writes here, we are looking forward to that. Is that what you are looking forward? Is that where your hope is rooted in? The resurrected, glorified Christ and His promise that there's going to be a new earth and He's going to restore everything. Is that part of the gospel that you share with others? Is that part of the good news that we share with others? Paul says that the resurrection of the dead is the hope in which we were saved. It will be the glorious climax of God's saving work that He began at your regeneration. You see, we are keep on being saved, and one day we will ultimately completely be saved at the resurrection of the dead when Christ returns. It will mark, the resurrection will mark the final end of any and all sin that separates us from God. In liberating us from sin and all its consequences, the resurrection will free us to live with Jesus, to gaze upon Him, and to enjoy His uninterrupted fellowship with Him forever, with no threat that anything will ever again come between us and Him. And so, friends, if we are going to be guided by the world around us, we are not going to have an eternal perspective. But let us keep on remembering at least these five things, that there's only two destinations, two eternal destinations. My choices and actions got an influence in this life and the life to come. We live and worship before an audience of one. God is sovereign. He is even sovereign over my choices. And His will be done. He will purpose what He has willed to purpose. He will purpose and He will bring to fulfillment what He has designed and planned. And let us not forget our ultimate home. Friends, let us pray together. Our Heavenly Father, You tell us not to fix our eyes and to build all our hope and all our trust on popular culture and popular teachings and things of this present world, things that's going to fade away. But You have called us to build on what is eternal and what will still be here in a billion years from now. And so I pray, Heavenly Father, will You give us the eyes of faith to fix our eyes, not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. And Holy Spirit, will you guide us and lead us to focus on Jesus Christ, our soon to return Lord and Savior, to the praise and the glory of your wonderful name and your wonderful grace, and for our good. In Jesus' name we pray that. Amen. Friends, may you enjoy a blessed week.
Since first I thought His will will be.
Come Holy Spirit, move among us. Come Holy Spirit, flow living water, flow within us, flow living water.